Well, good morning. It's good to see you here today. We are, those of us who were at VBS this week might be moving just a little bit slower.
That may just be me.
Sounds like my microphone might be messing up again. But we are glad that you are here today and hope you'll enjoy our worship of the High King of Heaven. We're going to be singing here in just a moment. Hymn number 588. Before we do that, let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this day that you have given us. We ask that you, Lord, we pray that you would be pleased with our worship today. We ask that you would, Lord, you would take our worship and you would bless it, and we'd be the people you called us to be. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
you need it, it's in the inside cover of your hymnal. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. May you come forward for the offering, please. Father, again, we come to you grateful to call you Father and King. We pray that as we give, we do so with grateful hearts. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
will be chapter 12:27. Now the dedication of the wall of Jerusalem, they sought out the Levites in all their places to bring them to Jerusalem to celebrate the dedication with gladness, both with thanksgiving and singing, with cymbals and stringed instruments and harps. Now 30:31. Then the priests and Levites purified themselves and purified the people, the gates, and the wall. So I brought the leaders of Judah up to the wall and appointed two large thanksgiving choirs. One went to the right hand of the wall toward the refuse gates. And 38. The other thanksgiving choir went opposite way. And I was behind them with half of the people on the wall going past the tower of the ovens as far as the broad wall. And then lastly, 43:47. Also that day they offered great sacrifices and rejoiced for God and made their rejoice with great joy. The women and the children also rejoiced, so that the joy of Jerusalem was heard on the water wall. And at the same time, some were appointed over the rooms of the storehouse for the offerings, the first fruits, and the tithes to gather into them from the fields of the cities, the portions specified by the law for the priests and Levites, for Judah rejoiced over the priests and Levites who ministered. Both the singers and the gatekeepers kept the charge of their God and the charge of the purification, according to the command of David and Solomon his son. For in the days of David and Asaph of old, there were chiefs of the singers and songs of praise and thanksgiving to God. To the day of Zerubbabel and in the day of Nehemiah, all Israel gave the portions for the singers and the gatekeepers, a portion for each day. They also consecrated holy things for the Levites, and the Levites consecrated them for the children of Aaron. Praise be to God.
We are going to be in Nehemiah this morning, obviously, and then next Sunday we will finish Nehemiah, and then the following Sunday will be the beginning of our Bible conference, and I hope you'll come for that. We've got Louis Porter will preach for us, Leland Johnson will preach for us, Scott Rogers will preach for us, and then Louis will finish the night. He probably has maybe the hardest task, Louis does, on Wednesday night, because he knows everybody in the place is wanting homemade ice cream. Right? I mean, so he knows that's going to be the hardest thing for that. And then on Sunday morning, as we August the 13th, we will have dinner on the grounds that morning as well. So, but today we will be looking at this idea of Nehemiah and the dedication of the wall, because remember when Nehemiah had gone to Jerusalem in the first place, the city had been completely destroyed. There were no walls there that would have kept invaders down, would not have given them any protection whatsoever. Nobody would have wanted to live there. I mean, I wouldn't want to live there. But they made sure that when they went, that they were going to rebuild these walls. And there were some things to celebrate. And in your notes, you see there are seven things that we could celebrate. Along with Nehemiah, he was able to go into the king of Persia, Artaxerxes, and you remember that if one of these Persian kings had some negative view of you entering his presence, he could just kill you. He can just kill you in a heartbeat. You didn't have to even give him a reason to do that. He could just choose that, and it would be okay. But what was remarkable about this is that Artaxerxes had previously said that he would not allow this city to be rebuilt. So for Nehemiah to go in and ask not do that with the king. But Nehemiah did. What a testimony to the character of Nehemiah, but ultimately to the goodness of God. Amen? The goodness of God. The second thing, Nehemiah had a well-developed plan for this rebuild. And you remember a long time ago when we were in this earlier part of Nehemiah, Nehemiah actually asked the king for the goods to rebuild the wall. Wait a minute. I mean, what would you have done? What would you have done if somebody had come and asked you permission to build something and said, oh, and by the way, will you give me everything I need to build that house? Well, maybe not, but he did. Another thing to thank God about. The third thing, Nehemiah, when he went back, to a group of people who were discouraged and disheartened, but he gave them a vision for what was going to happen. He re-energized these Israelites. The fourth thing, Nehemiah overcame tremendous obstacles from outsiders, but he actually had people that were in Jerusalem that were fighting him rebuilding this wall. That's amazing for me to think, but because of the internal strife, at one point he had to shut down all of the building because of the internal strife. Not because of the external strife, but because of what was going on in that city. He shut it down and resolved it, and they got back to work. Remember, the fifth thing that we can thank God for in this book is it took Nehemiah how long to rebuild this? 52 days. 52 days. That was no small undertaking. But it took him 52 days, which is remarkable. The sixth thing, Nehemiah encouraged and participated in a national revival. And the thing I love about this is that Nehemiah saw the value of Ezra leading that revival, and he didn't need any kind of notoriety in that process. The seventh thing that we saw last week was that Nehemiah was able to repopulate that city. Verse 27 gives us the purpose of this occasion. It was to celebrate this dedication and do so with joy. When we read 31 to 38, you can see that Nehemiah started two choirs singing. One went, he divided them in such a way that by the time that they met, they had encircled the entire city singing praises to their God. They also then did sacrifices. This celebration involved a number of things. This morning, we're going to look at those four things. Now, it is a given that they were committed to the Word of God. Do you remember that they stood the very first time they called together the people? What did they tell Nehemiah and Ezra that they wanted? The Word of God. They wanted the Word of God. And they read that Word of God for hour after hour after hour while the people were standing. They wanted the Word of God. So it is a given that everything that they do is flowing from this understanding of the Word. But notice with me, if you will, in verse 30. We won't look at every one of these verses. But notice this first thing was purification. Nehemiah cites there that the priests and the Levites cleansed themselves and cleanse the people and the gates and the wall. He doesn't give us exactly this method of cleansing, but if you look at some passages in the Old Testament, and I believe I put them there in the note sheet, Exodus 19, Leviticus 16, Numbers 8, Numbers 19, it included water baptism, animal sacrifices, fasting, and abstinence as well. Can I ask you a question today? What is the one thing? What do we think the one thing, the greatest obstacle for worship is today? Would you say it's our sin? I would have to say that our sin at times gets in the way of us worshiping the one true God. And for a person to enter into God's presence, that sin has got to be dealt with in some fashion. Now, to the Jew that was looking forward for the coming of Messiah, that was one thing. But the scripture says that we can enter into the throne of grace, meek and mild as lamb. Is that what it says?
Boldly.
Try it, it says boldly. Boldly. But we can do it boldly because of the blood of Jesus Christ. Not because of me and who I am. The fact that I am a pastor in a church gives me no more of a right to enter the presence of Jesus boldly than you as a church member to enter boldly into the presence of Christ. The key is the blood of Christ and us being able to do that because our sin has been forgiven. These washings that we see in Nehemiah 12, they are sort of the equivalent in a way of our baptism. We know that water baptism doesn't make us holy. Water that goes to this baptistry could just as easily gone to the toilet in the women's restroom. You say, why would you, in the world would you bring that up? Just to prove my point that it's not the water that makes it special. It's who is in there in the picture of them being redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ that makes it special. Amen?
Amen.
And by the way, next Sunday we're going to have a baptism.
Yes.
And if you've not been immersed, if you want to participate in that baptism, you're welcome to do that. Just let me know. And we would need to have a conversation ahead of time. This isn't, you know, this isn't like a McDonald's where you're going to go order a hamburger and get it. It's not like we're going to have some assembly line and just rushing people through the water. So I would want to chat with you a little bit. And truth be told, I don't baptize people very quickly. I don't. If they come to Christ, I want them to develop that relationship with Jesus and to see that there's a consistency there and that there is a trust in what God has done in their lives, so that when we do baptize them, they're not thinking that that baptism has any saving merit whatsoever. So, if you'd like to participate in that, just let me know. But baptism, we know, is a symbolic act that declares a disavowal of sin and a commitment to follow Jesus. Or, as you've heard me say, and multiple other people say, baptism is an outward sign of an inward change. And that's what it is. It's not holy in the sense of the water that's holy. Now, our passage here denoted a symbolic cleansing from sin, revealing as well that you and I need that same cleansing. Baptism is a symbol, a picture of a death to sin, and a renewal of life and a commitment to follow Jesus. It is a cleansing symbol, and think about this. Jesus, having taken on our sin, he actually assumed the position of somebody that needed to be baptized. When we talk about Jesus identifying with us, he even went to the extent of getting dunked under the water by his cousin, John Baptist. That's amazing to me. Did he need to be baptized? No, he didn't need to be baptized. But remember, the scripture says Jesus wasn't made like sin for us. It says that Jesus was made sin for us, that we might be made the likeness of Christ in him.
Amen.
That's an amazing thought. And all of these pictures of cleansing in the Old Testament are like a tunnel vision to the Lord Jesus in the New. Nehemiah understood as well that a person who enters God's presence
had to have clean hands and a pure heart. And when we properly understand that, that can only happen through the person of Jesus. You know, Nehemiah even understood that those walls needed to be purified as well, because that city had been defiled with the hands of Gentiles for 150 years. Many Jews had lost their lives. So Nehemiah wanted everything, including the walls surrounding the city that formed the outer point of the city, to be cleansed. Would you go with me just a minute in your mind to when Jesus was living in the groups that were around during that day with the Jews? You had the Sadducees, you had the Pharisees as well. And you remember these zealots whom Jesus encountered, they were much more concerned about the external than the internal. You know, Jesus even said to them, you know, you're very concerned about the outer part of the cup, but you don't care what's been on the inside. You know, when I was at school drinking coffee every day, people, multiple times a day, you know, if my cup was sitting there, it had seen the better part of a few years of probably not being washed. And I'm sure you're not like that. And so, I mean, invariably, I would just go and I'd pour coffee in it. I wouldn't even look at it. Morning, I just walk in the door and go and start drinking out of it. Wouldn't even care what it looked like or nothing. I know it may grow shit out. It is what it is. And I got paid back for it one time. I was not even looking at it, and I poured it in there, and I looked, and there was this huge roach in it. And guess what? From that point onward, I washed my cup every day. Every single day. I cared about what was on the outside. These Pharisees were so concerned about the externals. They care about how they looked. They wanted to make sure that they looked the part of the leader of the Jews. And they did look the part. But sadly, folks, on the inside, they missed the gospel of God. Is that you today? Do you make sure that you portray this image of uprightness and goodness and things to the world, yet on the inside you know that you've not been redeemed? That there's not a change in your heart that winds up growing out and being revealed? Can I tell you the reason why people are dropping out of churches right and left across this country? It's because their view of holiness has only been an external view. I tell you, when somebody has been redeemed from the inside out, they want to live for Jesus. They do. And they will not depart. They'll sin. Oh, yeah. But they will never depart. So when we look at this passage back at Nehemiah again, these Pharisees, looking the part, were actually full of greed and self-indulgence. And this passage reminds me today that when we worship God only with clean hands and clean hearts that have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus. Can I tell you something else? This passage tells me how seriously the people of Israel took the worship of Jehovah. He was not frivolous. He is not a frivolous God. We should not worship him in some silly fashion, as though he were some fast food God that we can approach and just sort of adding to the rest of our day. Look, he is either going to be the king of the universe, the king of your life, or he's not coming at all. Amen? Anything short of that, and you're not understanding who he is. So, secondly, the music. So we this snapshot of this idea of purification, but I love this second one. The second component, this celebration, was music. And Nehemiah used these choirs to sing. And they moved in two different directions, as we talked about, to encompass the entire city. They used musical instruments as well. Did you know that the church has been divided over the issue of the use of musical instruments in worship? It was really not until the 1800s that Presbyterians and Baptists and Congregationalists began to use instruments as a part of regular worship. It's hard for me to argue against those things when the Old Testament is full of the use of instruments. It's hard for me to do that, but there are churches that do. I've heard that some churches want piano and organ and nothing else. I've even heard of churches who will allow everything except drums. I don't really know. Really, the real question is, an author, a commentator named Derek Thomas wrote, he said, really, the real question is, what instruments best accompany congregational singing? And you know what my answer is to that question? All of them. And that's his implied answer in the text as well as he is writing. You know, would I like violins on a Sunday? I would love violins. Would I like a trombone or a trumpet or drums or someone else playing guitar? I would love that. I mean, y'all, I always laugh, but I like playing guitar. But I've told you before that if somebody comes up and they want to play, I will put mine in my case and play at home and be happy. You know, I don't have some monopoly on that space there. I would love that if somebody would come in and play. But another point is for us to consider this morning, and listen carefully here, is the subject of that music. When we get together as a group, we ought to be singing about the excellencies and the wonder of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, and not about me and my feelings and things. I'm sorry. He is worthy of all the songs that we could possibly write. And you'll notice sometimes when I pick out the hymns, which I don't do that much, Sherry and I sort of laugh about this. I sort of gravitate toward the numbers 1 through about 100 in the hymnal. I do. I love those. I love those. And yet there's nothing wrong with singing the others. We've got to make sure, though, that every song is about Him and His glory, His kindness, His person. And we ought to sing joyfully. I guarantee you, at the George Strait concert Friday night, there were more people singing at that concert with more gusto than the average Christian in a worship service. What do you think, Erin? She was there. Now, I'm not saying there, but y'all did that. He's got some good music, though. He does. Yet George Strait didn't redeem anyone. Did he? My joy ought to be gathering. You understand, when we get together and we sing about Jesus, we're the only people in the world doing this. The only people in the world. You know, the key to a worship song is the subject. Every act of worship should be marked with celebration and joy in the sound of glorious God exalting music. Another quote from Derek Thomas. And let me say this, just because a song is in a hymnal and it's older doesn't make it good or bad. And just because a song has been written in the last 10 years doesn't make it good or bad. There's some songs in the hymnal that I struggle with, theologically speaking. There are a lot of worship songs I struggle with, theologically speaking.
need to move on before I get anybody really mad.
Okay. So the third thing is this idea of gratitude. So we've got purification, we've got music. The third point is gratitude. And we can see in verse 27, these choirs celebrated the dedication with gladness, with thanksgiving, with singing. And in my mind, can I tell you that when I read these verses, this ought to be every Sunday worship. It should. It really should. Now, there are other references to gratitude throughout the passage today. But just like people who have truly been deeply forgiven, those people tend to be those who will forgive more quickly and more deeply than others. Have you noticed that? The people that tend to extend grace the most are the people who have received the most grace. And so I would urge us, as we think about that, to look at our own hearts. You and I have been forgiven greatly. Our first impulse ought to be forgive them. Well, they didn't ask for it. It's okay. You can treat them with a spirit of forgiveness until they do ask. That's the command of Scripture, by the way. God has not called us to be critical of other human beings, period. He has not called us to gossip. He has not called us to talk about other people behind their backs. To do so is to sin against the High King of Heaven and to sin against the people with whom you're talking and the person about whom you're talking. So gratitude, though. You know, one thing I have found, that the best singing comes from a rejoicing heart. So, when I think about, I never saw Brother Billy on the first row singing. I never saw him. But you talk about a man who had the joy in his heart. He let it be known by the way that he sang. Amen. I tend to think we probably ought to be more like that than anyway else when it comes to singing, when it comes to gratitude. The Hebrew word for joy, joyful, rejoicing, occurs five different times in verse 43 alone. This wasn't a mindless joy. The source of the gladness was God himself. Remember that Paul said in Philippians 4:4, he said, rejoice in the Lord sometimes. Always. And then he even said it again, didn't he? In case we forgot. And again he says, I say, rejoice. Folks, I keep coming back to the idea of, and I mentioned this in Sunday school today, there's a group of people who are finding real connection and community on the internet called ex-evangelicals. They are people who were formerly part of evangelical churches who have left it for whatever the reason may be. Some of those folks are leaving are just discouraged and they are disappointed in churches, in church members. They're disappointed maybe in God for some reason, although they don't really have a prerogative to be disappointed with him. But could they be looking at our lives and the problems that we're going through and hearing us talk, hearing us complain, hearing us be negative, and never hearing about the purpose of God and the providence of God in our life and him doing as he wills with us what he wants to. Is that you today? Are you helping this evangelical movement? Because that person's hope is not in you. And it's not in me. That person's hope is in Jehovah. But people will get their cues about what they believe. They shouldn't do this, but they will get that from us. And if we are never joyful, what do they think about Jesus? You know, they think he's like a funeral all the time. Did you hear that line in this song that we sang this morning? The one he calls me friend. Did you hear that line where it says that he trampled on the grave? That's what we need to sing about at a funeral for a believer. Do we believe that? Do we believe that this is the end? Do we believe this is it, or do we really believe that's it across the street? I don't believe that's it across the street. Do you? We got to live like that. We got to live like we believe that Jesus trampled on that grave. And that gives me hope. That gives me hope. So, fourthly, and I'm going to skip a couple of things to giving. The fourth note in this celebration was the joy of giving. Giving always accompanies people who are committed to worship and who are grateful. It always does. That giving is not necessarily financial, though. Sometimes it is. Sometimes it's service. It can be a number of things. We saw recently when we were looking at Nehemiah that the people were committed to giving over and above their tithe to support the work of Jerusalem and the temple and the priests. And in the New Testament, the tithe is never mentioned. So what are we supposed to give there? Does it go down since we're in the New Testament? We keep going down every year, you know, sort of like, you know, in Mississippi, you don't have to pay certain taxes when you hit 65 and stuff. Well, is that what happens when you, as you get older, you're going to decrease your tithe? So by the time you hit 80, it's down to 2% or something? You know, just being silly. No, I really believe that we need to understand that everything that we have is God's. Everything. And I need to figure out how much I can live on, but then be willing to give away everything else if it is something he's called to. Giving was mandated by Moses and the law, but by the time of Nehemiah's time was met with enthusiasm and commitment, and it was the result of faithful worship. So let me ask you a couple of questions as we close. In looking at your sense of worship, your sense of celebration, do you genuinely understand that for you and for me to approach the Holy of Holies, that our hearts and our hands have got to be pure? And there's only one way for that to happen, and that's through the cross of Christ. It's not going to happen outside of that. When the music is playing, you know, just because something, you know, when we sing a hymn, I love the hymns. If you think I don't love hymns, you don't know me. I love the hymns, but I also love some of the new hymns that are being written as well. I love the slow songs. I love some of the fast songs. So what does it sound like I like? Exactly. Now, is my favorite? I tell you, when you're in one of these pipe organ churches and you hear holy, holy, holy on those, man, I just feel like jumping up and shouting like a Baptist. I really do. I don't. But I do. But you know, I feel that same way when we have Chad and Robin playing a hymn or piano, or when Cherry is singing a song, or Tammy, or anybody else. Is that your heart? Can you sense the presence of God in the subject of the songs that we're singing? So we've got this idea of purification. We've got this idea of music. Are you grateful? When people look at you, do they see a person whose heart is full of of gratitude for God, who is full of God's glory? And then give it. It ought to be like that on Sunday. When 15 people are here, or 150 are here, the number should be irrelevant. But I know this. When people are around enthusiastic Christians, you know what happens? They attract other people. And once they're attracted, you can begin to share the gospel. Would you pray with me today? Father, we thank you this day that you have given us. It is amazing to think that, Lord, before the world was created, the scripture says the Lamb was slain. I don't understand that. I don't understand that. You knew who was going to be redeemed at that point. You called them to yourself at that point. I don't understand. Lord, I pray that as we have quiet times, as we spend time in the Word, as we spend time just meditating on you, that our minds would, Lord, just that our minds would be baptized in the Word of God to the point where our thoughts are rooted in an understanding of who you are. Lord, we pray that we would be a church that would celebrate the way that Nehemiah and Ezra brought to Jerusalem after the rebuild. I pray that we would be a people that understand our purification, our holiness is something you've called us to. And you've called us to fight for it on one hand, but to rest in the cross of Christ on the other. Lord, I pray that we remember that you have called us to sing your glory. And that we would do so loudly and happily, regardless if we can carry a tune and a bucket. Lord, I pray as well that you would give us just a sense of gratitude that you have forgiven our sin. You have called us to yourself. You have saved us by your grace, not because we're good, but because you're good. And that we would be a people who give of ourselves, of our finances, of our time. Lord, I pray today that if there's someone here that has never professed faith in you, that they've just been playing games, that they've been more concerned about the outside of the coffee cup than the inside, that you would reveal that to them. We know that the gospel is not a game. We pray that we would understand that. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Robin, we'll just play today rather than sing. We're going to play a couple of verses of a hymn. Maybe you need to come and spend a moment at the altar and just pray. You don't have to do that. You can do that right where you're sitting. Make sure that you are right with God today and that you are committed to celebrating Him in every area of your life.
Thank you.
you. We do have a couple of announcements. Let's see. Tomorrow night, yoga will pick back up at 6:30. So if you, want to come and do that, ladies, that's a good thing. I don't think I could ever do that. Okay, I'm shaking. Yeah, I'm shaking. But that'll be 6:30 tomorrow night here. If you want to do that, you'll notice on Tuesday, believers are at mug shots, and then 6:30, the Not a Fan Bible Study, Youth Night, 5:30 to 6:30 on Wednesday. Then on the back of the bulletin tonight, we are pulled pork casserole, and tonight we'll be looking at Jonathan Edwards and revival tonight, singing a couple of the City Light hymns, some newer songs, which we're going to try to get them in the rotation a little bit so people will be knowing them better. Explorers Bible Study is getting ready to start in August as well, so you can see that box on the back. If you're visiting this morning, if you wouldn't mind using that QR code back there, and that'll take you right to our guest registration page. We'd love for you to fill those out, Matt Allen. Any other church-wide? Again, the BBS, I'll say this and then I'll stop. BBS was, we just had a lot of MVPs at BBS. We really did enjoy it. It was a lot of fun. To have that many kids sort of swirling around you, the neighbors did a great job with Rick, and Margie did snacks and did very well with that. She did crafts, whomever didn't.
All our teachers.
Oh, well, they were next, but there's, let's see, she crafts, Margie. Music, there you go. Did Lorraine just did a great job with music. And then every classroom teacher also just had a good time. And we had parents that told us they appreciated it. God chooses to work as he wants to work. A couple of Fridays ago, there were seven kids registered. And I was swallowing hard and trying to trust Jesus at the same time. And I think our final enrollment was about 45, which was good. That was very good. And was able to share the gospel on Friday night with moms and dads as well. So just pray for those families that have come during that time, and we'll contact them in the coming weeks. Last thing is that Bible conference, August 13th through the 16th, please come to each one of those services. Remember, there'll be a dinner on the grounds on the 13th after the AM service, and then our ice cream fellowship on Wednesday night. All right, I did not receive any prayer requests today, so we will stand and we'll be dismissed. Joe Barron, you're close this morning. Would you mind, sir?
Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for your bride that you blessed right here in Washington City. We thank you for the opportunity that we were able to show up and worship freely without fear of persecution, as most in this world don't have that opportunity, Lord. We're grateful for it. Lord, today we just want to lift up our minister and all of our church leaders. It is such a hard commission you placed on them. Lord, we just pray for their hearts, and they will seek your counsel on every decision that they make for our church. Lord, we're grateful for you. Lord, as we depart this week, we just continue to ask for opportunities to share your word. And when those opportunities come, Lord, let us not be fearful. And give us the courage to preach the good news of what you have done for us. And then even in our filth, the sin, we can still be called your children through your Son, Jesus Christ, and what he did on Calvary's cross. Lord, we thank you so much for everything. Please give us safety. Keep us coming to you. In Jesus' name, we ask all of you.